Hello and welcome to the National HIV Curriculum Lecture Series. My name is Brian Wood. This lecture will focus on Fostemsavir. Fostemsavir is the first and to date the only FDA-approved drug in a class of antiretroviral medications called attachment inhibitors. We will discuss what that means. Importantly, Fostemsavir is only available as an oral agent, and the recommended dosage is one tablet twice daily. It can be taken with or without food. This is the chemical structure of Fostemsavir, which is actually a prodrug. The active drug is called Temsavir. The advantage of administering Fostemsavir is it has better solubility and dissolution properties than Temsavir and is more stable under acidic conditions. However, Fostemsavir undergoes pretty rapid hydrolysis once it reaches the luminal surface of the small intestine brush border membrane. This hydrolysis, or cleavage of a side chain, is performed by alkaline phosphatase, as illustrated here, and this is what converts Fostemsavir to the active drug Temsavir. Temsavir, depicted here, is what is absorbed and what is detected in the plasma after a person takes Fostemsavir. So how does an attachment inhibitor work? As a reminder, attachment of the HIV viral particle to the CD4 host cell starts with attachment of the GP120 envelope glycoprotein to the CD4 receptor at the CD4 binding site. Temsavir binds near this CD4 binding site and prevents the conformational change of GP120 that is necessary for attachment to occur. Thus, it blocks the initial attachment of HIV virus to the host CD4 T cell. It can be classified as an entry inhibitor because of this mechanism of action, but I do want to highlight that the mechanism by which Fostemsavir blocks entry is different than the mechanism of other currently available entry inhibitors, drugs such as maraviroc, ibalizumab, and enfuvertide. To summarize some important points about the clinical usage of Fostemsavir. First, the FDA-approved indication is for heavily treatment-experienced adults with multi-drug-resistant HIV-1 infection. In clinical practice, this is indeed when we reach for Fostemsavir. It is generally used for individuals who have resistance to other drug classes, who have limited antiretroviral drug options, and who need a drug with a unique mechanism of action as part of their new salvage regimen. Fostemsavir does have some drug-drug interactions. You can see here a list of other medications that should be avoided. In particular, strong CYP3A4 inducers should be avoided, and there are several other medications that you can see listed here. Fostemsavir should be used with caution if a person has a history of prolonged QTC, or if a person is taking medications known to prolong the QT interval or cause torsades. And Fostemsavir does raise levels of statins to some degree. Statins are not contraindicated, but what is recommended is to use the lowest possible starting dose of the statin and monitor for statin side effects. Now let's examine some key clinical trial data which led to approval of Fostemsavir and emphasizes some important clinical points about the medication. This study, called BRIGHTE, examined the virologic efficacy of Fostemsavir as part of combination therapy for heavily treatment-experienced adults with HIV. You can see here the enrollment criteria on the left. The trial did have a relatively complex design that included both a randomized cohort and also a non-randomized cohort. One significant difference between these study groups was there was an effort to only include individuals in the randomized cohort if they had at least one fully active ARV agent that could be included in the optimized background regimen and added to Fostemsavir therapy. On the other hand, participants entered the non-randomized cohort if they had zero fully active ARV drugs that could be added to Fostemsavir. Individuals in this cohort still received optimized background therapy, meaning the most active combination of additional ARVs possible, but those in the non-randomized cohort generally did not have a fully active drug that could be added to Fostemsavir. Participants in the randomized cohort received either Fostemsavir plus their baseline failing regimen or placebo plus their baseline failing regimen for a total of 8 days. At that point, viral loads were assessed, and we will look at that viral load response data at day 8. And at that point, participants in the randomized cohort transitioned to Fostemsavir plus an optimized background regimen. Enrollees in the non-randomized cohort simply switched right away to Fostemsavir plus an optimized background regimen. Here is a description of the baseline participant characteristics. I would highlight that the median CD4 count was below 100 in both groups. A proportion of both groups had baseline viral load above 100,000. And you can see the proportion in each study group that had 2 fully active agents in the optimized background regimen. Again, that's the combination of meds added to Fostemsavir. You can see the proportion with 1 fully active agent and the proportion with 0 fully active agents, which was quite high in the non-randomized cohort. This is the primary outcome, which was change in HIV RNA or viral load after 8 days of either Fostemsavir or placebo added to the baseline failing regimen. Again, this was all in the randomized cohort, but clearly you can see that Fostemsavir led to significantly better reductions in HIV RNA level as compared to placebo. Here, you can see additional results. This is the proportion of participants who achieved a suppressed viral load over time. This includes participants in both the randomized and non-randomized cohorts. You can see that at 48 weeks, 62% of those in the randomized cohort and 48% in the non-randomized cohort achieved a viral load below 40 copies. While this may seem relatively low, recall that participants in this trial had multi-class drug resistance and very few antiretroviral options remaining. So I would say this is a very positive and notable finding. We have also seen longer-term follow-up data from the trial, and I will show you some of those results. For example, here you can see the virologic response in the 2 study cohorts documented out to 96 weeks. And here you can see the change in CD4 T cell count that occurred for participants in both groups, again out to 96 weeks. Overall, Fostemsavir is a relatively well-tolerated drug. Side effects were not common in the clinical trial, and I would add that in my clinical experience, Fostemsavir tends to be well-tolerated. In my experience, individuals who struggle to take Fostemsavir more commonly struggle with the BID dosing, which can be challenging as opposed to struggling with side effects. Let's review drug resistance and what may occur with virologic failure while taking Fostemsavir. One point to note is that a person who is taking Fostemsavir may develop virologic rebound or virologic failure if they are missing doses of the drug or if they are missing doses of the other components of the regimen. And if this happens, what has been shown in the research studies is that resistance-associated mutations can develop in the GP120 envelope subunit, and these resistance mutations can significantly compromise the antiviral activity of Fostemsavir. Now, a few additional points about antiviral activity of the drug and resistance. Fostemsavir can be used regardless of HIV tropism, and in this regard is very different than the entry inhibitor maraviroc. So tropism testing is not necessary prior to initiating Fostemsavir. If a person has never taken Fostemsavir before, we usually presume that it will be active. It has a novel mechanism of action and very, very limited cross-resistance with other antiretroviral medications. As noted here, the only real antiretroviral cross-resistance we worry about would be if a person had developed resistance mutations in GP120 due to virologic failure while receiving ibalizumab or maraviroc, other entry inhibitors, and in clinical practice, this phenomenon is quite rare. Now, a couple of other important notes. If a person does develop virologic failure while taking Fostemsavir, standard genotype testing does not give Fostemsavir resistance information, and so checking for Fostemsavir resistance can be quite difficult. Assays used to do that so far really are limited to research assays. Certain viral subtypes may have reduced susceptibility to Fostemsavir, but in clinical practice, these are quite rare. Viruses resistant to the GP41 inhibitor and fuvertide typically do retain susceptibility to Fostemsavir. So if a person previously took enfuvertide as part of a salvage regimen and developed virologic failure, usually Fostemsavir retains activity. And even when a person develops resistance to Fostemsavir, the other entry inhibitors tend to be active. Again, development of virologic failure and resistance on these complex salvage regimens that include multiple entry inhibitors is a relatively rare event in clinical practice, but these are important notes to keep in mind if you are seeing someone who fits that scenario. To summarize, Fostemsavir is an oral, twice-daily medication with a novel mechanism of action. It is a CD4 attachment inhibitor and is the only drug currently approved in that class. It is typically used as part of salvage antiretroviral therapy for heavily treatment-experienced individuals, often for individuals who have few other ARV options. It can be combined with other ARVs and with other entry inhibitors, and we generally give it with the most active background regimen possible. Overall, it is a well-tolerated medication with few drug-drug interactions, though it is important always to review a person's medication list and review any medications that may be contraindicated, in particular strong CYP3A4 inducers. It does raise statin levels to some degree, and we do use it with caution if combining with other drugs that may prolong the QTC or cause torsades. I summarized some considerations around resistance mutations that may occur in the GP120 envelope in a person who develops virologic failure while taking Fostemsavir. Thank you.
The production of this National HIV Curriculum Mini-Lecture was supported by funding from the Health Resources and Services Administration.